There's those little inserts. Those are for new people that are visiting us. We would love for you to take a look in that bulletin. Just write down a little bit of what you might be looking for in a church. Put a little request, a suggestion, prayer request, and just let us get to know you a little bit more. And also in the back table, we have a special gift for you if you're just joining us for the first time. And the next thing we have is Family Fun Day. Whoa! It's coming up June 13th, 11 a.m. to 2 p.m., and we need many, 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 many volunteers to make this event a success and to love on our great community. Holly will be in the back, or in the foyer, I should say, after service. Please go give her a shout out if you have questions or if you want to sign up. That would be great. Sign up. Holly will put you to work. It'll be awesome. And then we can give back to our great community that we're all a part of.
Oh, King who conquered the grave, when he is the Lamb who was slain. When he is the King who conquered the grave, when he is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy, worthy, worthy. Oh, this is amazing grace. This is unfailing love.
beautiful to love us, Father. Done on that cross, Lord, to give us life, not just a simple, quiet life, but life abundantly, Lord. Sometimes I don't even think I personally just really know who you are and how much abundance of a blessing you want to bestow on my life, because I don't look and see the beauty that's all around me. Forgive me, Father. Let me see you more clearly, Jesus. Let us all see you in our neighbor's eyes. Let us see you, Jesus. Let us see through your eyes the beauty that's all around us and the people that are around us. Give us a heart, Father, to love one another and to love you and to keep you close each and every moment of every day. Bless you, Jesus. Inhabit the praises of your people today. In Jesus' name, everybody says, amen.
Well, welcome to Sunday. Good to have you here. A couple family items that I thought would be helpful for you all to know. So we'll just pick and choose as we go here. Scott, I'll let you stand up. So you told me earlier today that some things were changing for you guys. Can you guys want to stand up here? So just tell me what's going on.
Well, a week from today, I will be heading to Charleston, South Carolina area to relocate for work. And then I'll be back in the middle of June to grab my wife and kids to come back down.
Now, we didn't vote on this.
We did. Well, it was unanimous.
Yeah, I bet it was. Well, we just really appreciate you two and family, you guys. I know you've been real active in our sound and help us do a lot of things here. And we'll miss you. But your brother and family still live here, so you can't leave forever.
Right. So, okay. We'll be back up to go to Killington.
Okay. And just. Okay. So, you guys were gone here last week. Some tough things. Can you describe what's up?
Well, Silas wanted to give Sarah a weekend away in New Hampshire for Mother's Day over at Dartmouth. So, no, Sia, he's been the last week or so before he was diagnosed. Ellie had a stomach bug.
Diagnosed with what? Because not everybody knows.
Type 1 diabetes, our little 2-year-old. we thought he had a stomach bug, and then he was asking for water all the time. And if your kid ever has that, come see us, we'll test him. And then Saturday morning, he didn't want to get out of his bed. And if you know Silas, he's an absolute animal. And so we knew something was wrong. So we got him down to urgent care, and they tested his urine, and it came back his sugars and his ketones were off the charts. And so we put him over to Dartmouth and spent the whole weekend there. We got home Monday afternoon.
So now what's the new regime?
Basically, the first thing he wakes up in the morning, he gets his little finger pricked. We test his blood glucose. He has breakfast. He gets a shot. Lunchtime, he gets his finger pricked. He has his lunch. Gets two shots. One to correct for his lunch, and then one for a long-lasting. So dinner time, he gets his finger pricked again. Has his dinner, gets another shot. Before bed, he gets his finger pricked. And then usually around 2 or 3 in the morning, Sarah and I get up and do it again. That's on a good day. If his sugars are all over the place, then it's more finger pricks, more shots. Like yesterday was a very tough day. So we're still finding that balance in all this.
Say what you've learned from your son.
Yeah. I'll just show you. Hey, Sai, can I check your finger? That's obedience right there. We'll do it later, buddy. What I just asked him to do was going to hurt, and he knows it, and he has no idea why. He has no idea why Sarah and I are pricking his fingers and giving him shots, but he just trusts us. He trusts that we're doing what's best for him, that we have his best interest at heart. And I was thanking God the other day for his spirit, for his willingness to do that. And that's when God said to me, you know, that's what I need from you. That's what I need from all of you. Sometimes it's going to hurt, and you're not going to know why, but trust me. And it's a profound thing to learn from a two-year-old.
Let's pray for the little guy. Father, we just thank you for Silas and for the right diagnosis. And we pray now, as he grows up, for Sarah and Justin, that they can continue to be strength, be faithful, and that you use this in a great way. We know that you have designed all of these things, and we trust you in Christ's name. Amen. Thank you. Anybody else got something we got to talk about? Okay. Okay. Newlyweds. Yeah, that's right. We did have a wedding last week, didn't we? You're already dressing the same. Is that impressive? I think that's impressive. Who picked the colors this morning? We give our wholehearted approval, I'll tell you that. A lot of things happened really quick after church last week. For those of you who didn't come, you missed it. It was a really awesome wedding. And we're really happy for both of you. Okay, Dee, thank you. Okay, take your Bibles, please, and let's turn to James chapter 5. We're going to talk about the title of this particular sermon is, Am I Materialistic or Generous? And it seems, as you look out across our culture, that everything is tied to money. Notice that? It seems like your happiness, your rest, your peace of mind, your future, everything is tied into finances. And there is a reality part of that. But what I'd like us to do is, James was talking about a lot of practical things in life. And he jumps right into this whole thing, seems out of context, but he says, now listen, there's some things I want to talk to you about with your finances, because as a church, you need to work this out. And I just want to say we have a really generous church, and I'm very grateful to be here. But I think there's some things that will actually be helpful as we study this together. So the first, there's a couple principles I want to share with you. The first is, we're going to talk about materialistic first, and then we're going to talk about what it means to be generous. So the first word here on materialistic is someone who hoards his wealth for himself. And we're going to look at a couple texts this morning, one of which actually was the one that Bob Goddard read this morning. We didn't talk, but that's later on in our text here. But in this particular section in James, he's talking about somebody who's hoarding. And I've read through James before, but that word hoarding just jumped right out at me. And you tell me, what is the word that is used multiple times here as we start reading? James chapter 5, starting in verse 1. Listen now, you rich people, weep and wail because of the misery that is coming to you. Your wealth has rotted and moths have eaten your clothes. Your gold and silver are corroded. Their corrosion will testify against you and eat your flesh like fire. You have hoarded wealth in the last days. Look, the wages you failed to pay the workmen who mowed your fields are crying out against you. The cries of the harvesters have reached the ears of the Lord Almighty. You have lived on the earth in luxury and self-indulgence. You have fatted yourselves for the day of slaughter. You have condemned and murdered innocent men who are opposing you. The common word there is what? You. It's an indictment here. And he's saying, listen, you have all these finances and you've hoarded it. The issue is not whether you're wealthy or poor. The issue is what are you doing with what you have? It's about the focus here. And in this particular case, James is really coming down on them saying, everything is about you. And it shouldn't be. It's not about you. It's about what God has placed you in your particular situation to minister to those around you. And so he's really coming down strong here. And he's saying, listen, your people have done work for you, and you haven't paid them. And what would happen in days like this, by the way, it mentions here at the end that you've murdered people. Poor people with debts would be thrown into prison until they could pay off their debt. Now, the logic, you hear that one? You're thrown into prison to pay off debt so you can pay off your debt. Well, you can't pay off your debt because you're in prison. So what would happen is these people who are indebted, they would have to sell everything they had, and they would have to sell their family off as servants or slaves. And many times they would end up dying of starvation. I mean, it was a hard situation. And he's saying, listen, you are not doing right. You need to share what you have for the ministry of others. And you need to be thinking about that. You know, we've watched shows on TV about the hoarders. Anybody watch that? I can't watch it too long because it's kind of like it's suffocating to me to watch that kind of thing. But, you know, when you start building tiers on the floor and you walk over stuff and you can't find stuff after a while, there's something wrong. There's something off there. And actually, I knew a lady here in town who did that. And you would never know. She used to come to church here. And I didn't know much about her. I just knew a bit about the family. But one day I went to her house. And I was blown away, actually. And because she had died, actually, and they were selling her stuff. Wow. And they'd cleaned up the house, but it was like... And he's saying, here, what are you doing with what God has given to you? And this really is about finances here this morning. That's what the text is. But quite frankly, in my opinion, it's what are you doing with what God has given to you? If God has given you an organized mind to organize and create things, then you ought to be doing that. Quite frankly, it's great to have Holly back involved in Family Fun Day again. And she's a little misorganizer. And she does really, really good at that. And so I had talked to Jason about that, and he says, Holly's got it all covered. She's got everything coordinated and got everything organized, and all she needs is people to show up, and we'll do this thing. Well, even though she's pregnant, she's still doing her organizing piece, which she's really good at. Others of you are good at other things. Listening. Some of you come in and listen to verses in Awana. Or call people up and then actually ask a couple questions and listen. These are giftings that God has given to you, and you really need to use them. So whatever God has given you, I would say you need to really think about that and then use it. Not only will you benefit those you're helping, but you yourself will be blessed because you're using the gifts God has given to you. Do you know what those are? You see, materialism is not about how much money you make. It's not about the car you drive, where you go on vacations. It's not about the job you have. It's not about the prestige. It's not about none of that. It's your perspective of what you do with what you got. And the challenge is for you, I would say, especially in this area of money, is does any heartbeat ever go off when you see somebody else who has a need and there's like, boy, should I do something about that? I think we need to have that sensitive spirit. When you do, what happens is I think the Spirit of God can direct people to share with one another. Now, I think you can be guilted into it. And I'm not talking about that. I'm not talking about being guilted into it. But just think of the joy of being able to help others. So ponder that, I guess. And don't hoard for yourself. The second principle is this, in being materialistic, is someone who tries to buy what only God can give. Sometimes I think we try to buy something. God is wanting to give us some things. For instance, I put them here. You can buy a bed, but not sleep or peace of mind. You know, everybody thinks if they get just the right bed, we'll be fine. Well, There's other things going on inside your mind that a bed doesn't help. You can buy books, but not a brain. You can buy a house, but not a home. And you know what that is when you can go in and you can just feel at home. And sometimes there's other people's, and some of you folks here have got the gift of hospitality. And when people come into your home, and when I come and visit, it's like I'm home. That's home. There's an atmosphere that's created there. It's a blessing. You can buy medicine, but you cannot buy health. You can buy amusements, but not happiness. We seem in our culture that we have to be so amused by so many things. And what God really wants is, He wants us to be happy and enjoy life. Joy is one of the fruits of the Spirit. But we can't run away from things. We have to face certain things. You can buy companions, but not true friends. So the issue is, on the bottom of your first page here of notes, the materialistic person believes that the money you have is the result of your hard work with no results from God or His eternal purposes. And so people like that think, this is my money because I earned it. I understand that, but it's not true. It's not true. It's not yours, by the way. That is diametrically opposed to our culture. If you were to go say, you know, to your boss or whoever gives you your paycheck saying, thank you, but that's not my money, they'll look at you like you just jumped out of a plane. Say, well, you earned it. Say, yeah, I worked for it, but it's actually God's money. Wouldn't that shock some people if you said that, huh? So let's look here further about the whole concept of being generous. And there is such a concept of spiritual gifting, of giving. And there are some people in the world who are just, God has gifted them with finances, and they are extremely generous. R.G. Letourneau, who I knew growing up, a story of him, he was the man who develops these great big earth-moving piece of equipment. They have it's like a big, I don't know what you call it, but it's like a big barge almost. And you get a couple bulldozers behind it, and they push this thing, and it just scrapes, and dirt piles up in the back of this vehicle. He makes those kind of things. He's a wealthy, wealthy man. And when we talk about tithing, we talk about giving God the first 10%, then living off the 90%. And they said, well, you know, he could give lots of money. In fact, his philosophy was, is to give God 90% and live off 10%. And you say, well, of course he could, because he made millions and millions of dollars. And I say, you ever notice that your life spending goes up as you make more money? It does. It's just, it ratchets up. You just keep going higher and higher. And he made a philosophy because he was a godly Christian, and he said, I will give this to God. And he did. And there are a number of people in the Bible who were extremely wealthy, and they were godly, and they were generous. I thought, wasn't this a wonderful example? So point number three is to be generous, is willingly gives to the needs of others. The emphasis there is willingly gives. It's not that you grudgingly give and, you know, little boy was riding home with his dad and after church. And they were kind of tearing down the church and the preacher and the music and other people, you know. It was kind of was the habit. And little boy is in the back seat, and his dad was complaining about the pastor and the service and stuff. And little boy chirps up because he'd watched the offering and saw what his dad gave. And he said, yeah, but it wasn't a bad show for a buck, was it, Dad? Not a bad show for a buck. And I think what we want to do is, what can we do in ourselves where God has gifted us in an amazing way and then give back? So let's just look at a couple of these people in the scriptures and how they were so influential and so generous. They gave with no expectation in return. First person I have is Abraham. Abraham, of course, was very, very wealthy. And when he had gone down to Egypt, he was what we call the father of our faith. He was one of the great patriarchs of the Old Testament. And he had gone down to Egypt because the famine was in Israel. And when he came back up, it says that he was extremely wealthy with flocks and possessions and land and things like that. And so when it came time, when he and Lot, his nephew, they needed to split up because there were just too many of them. Abraham says to Lot, he says, you pick first. If you go right, I'll go left. If you go left, I'll go right. You pick. I just thought, isn't that interesting? And he was the one that was honored by God with his choices. The second man is Job. You read the book of Job, and you think of a man who goes through all sorts of problems and pain. And he did. He lost his entire family. He lost all his finances. But it talks in the middle in there that he would get up and he would go offer sacrifices for his children in case they did something wrong. I just thought, what a guy. You know, here's good old dad back home and the kids are out probably rebel rousing and he's back there serious with God offering peace offerings to God in case they did something wrong. Very wonderful person. The third person I have is Solomon. He was the son of David, King David, and he was started out really good in his spiritual walk with God. But I want you to turn there to 1 Kings, please, 10. And I want to read just a couple of verses here about Solomon. That's really interesting. It says, 1 Kings 10, verse 23. Of course, Solomon was gifted. He was very wise, but he handled a lot of finances too. Verse 23, it says, King Solomon was greater in riches and wisdom than all the other kings of the earth. The whole world sought audience with Solomon to hear his wisdom God put in his heart. Year after year, everyone who came brought a gift, articles of silver and gold, robes, weapons, spices, and horses and mules. Solomon accumulated chariots and horses. He had 1,400 chariots and 12,000 horses, which he kept in the chariot cities that were also around Jerusalem. And then this next verse, listen to this. The king made silver as common as Jerusalem as stones. You ever been to Jerusalem? All it is stones everywhere. And so when they have fights, they just pick up stones and they throw stones, you know? But he said silver was so common, it was just like stones. And of course, he built Solomon's temple, which was a great place of worship of God. He also built a palace and other things there. And so he gave back to God, and an amazing person. The fourth person is Barnabas in the New Testament. I'm going to ask you to turn to Acts chapter 4. A fellow who is very practical. Acts 4:32 talks about the early church, and there was a lot of need, and persecution was about to break out, and so there was some things that would bond the church together. Watch this, verse 32. All the believers were one in heart and mind. No one was claiming that any of his possessions was his own, but they shared everything they had. With the great power, the apostles continued to testify to the resurrection of the Lord Jesus, and much grace was upon all of them. There were no needy persons among them. It's really interesting. From time to time, those who owned lands or houses sold them, brought the money in from the sales, and put it at the apostles' feet, and it was distributed to anyone as they had need. Joseph, a Levite from Cyprus, whom the apostle called Barnabas, which also means son of encouragement, sold a field he owned and brought the money and put it at the apostles' feet. And I just listen to that and I think, you know, they have all this land. And what happened was the people who were wealthy would sell their stuff, and they would come, they'd bring it to the apostles. We would call them elders today. And they would say, okay, use it as you need, because there's people in need. Well, isn't that awesome? There's no need in that church, because God is moving and people are sharing. It wasn't about hoarding. Remember, we talked about somebody who's materialistic. They hoard for themselves. They take all their finances and they hold on to it for fear that it's going to go away. But you have somebody who's generous is they hold it like this. They hold it open-handed. And they say, use it as you will. In fact, it didn't even sound like there were strings attached to this when Joseph brought it. He just handed it over and said, here, use this as you see fit. Susanna, let's look at this one. This is out of Luke chapter 8. Does anybody know who Susanna was? This is a really awesome little passage here. And this actually solves some questions about how did Jesus provide when he was doing ministry and he had 12 disciples with him. How'd that work out? In other words, how'd they do that? Who is working? Because they're out teaching and helping other people. Watch this. This is Luke chapter 8, starting in verse 1. After this, Jesus traveled from one town to another, proclaiming the good news of the kingdom of God. The 12 were with him, and also some women who had been cured of evil spirits and diseases. Mary, called Magdalene, from whom 7 demons had come out. Joanna, the wife of Cusa, the manager of Herod's household. Susanna, and many others. Now, highlight this verse in your Bible, the next one. These women were helping to support them out of their own means. Now, you don't hear many preaching sermons on this, but here's the deal, is the disciples and Jesus were out busy doing ministry, and these women were supporting them. That's how the ministry happened. Apparently, they had some finances, and they, out of their finances, they help the other ministry happen. I think that's awesome teamwork. Now, we don't hear much about these women, except when it came crunch time, when Christ was crucified and everything. Some of these same women were the ones that stood up and followed Christ right to the cross and knew where he was buried and all those types of things and were very bold. But prior to getting there, these women were helping the ministry happen. I don't know what that does for you women, but I think that's great that they would even write this. It shows that there was a valuable place of teamwork in the New Testament, especially. And then, of course, Joseph of Arimathea, Matthew 27, and I won't go there, but basically it says he was a rich man. He was part of the Sanhedrin, part of the ruling leaders, very influential. And when Christ died, he went to Pilate at the risk of his own life, and he said, I want the body. And he took the body, and he put it in his own tomb, which had been hewn out of solid rock. So this was no simple gravesite. This was something that was very expensive, and he put Jesus' body in there. Now, the advantage of this one is the body didn't stay there, and so whether or not he got to use it again or not, we don't know, but the body was only going to stay there for a few days, so, you know, there was an advantage there. So I have you look at these, and these are all godly people whom God gave finances, and they didn't focus on themselves. They gave it away. They gave it away to the needs of the others, and they were part of this greater plan of building up the body. And God records their stories. And I trust that some of you will be that same way. And many of you are. Number 4, a generous person understands that God is the source of our wealth. They understand that. They just get that. In other words, they aren't the source of the wealth. God is the source of the wealth. The blessings of the Lord bring wealth, Proverbs 10:22. And then the text that actually Bob Goddard read this morning for his little talk is Luke 12:13-21. And basically the issue is about inheritance. And what's happening there is, and one of the most, anybody who's involved in law and finances knows that inheritance is one of the most prickly topics in families. It's just, it's nasty. Because what happens is when you start talking about finances, people think they own something. And they need a part of that pie. And sometimes parents will threaten their kids, if you don't do thus and so, then you're going to be cut out of the will. And it's this whole inheritance thing that's a real mess. It doesn't have to be that way, but that's how it is in many cases. And in this text, in Luke 12, 13 to 21, what is said is, the rich man says, you know, I got all this, the harvest has been very good, and I don't know where I'm going to put it all, so I'll build new barns, and I'll store more stuff for myself. And God says, you fool, your soul's going to be required of you. And it's over for him. And the issue was not that he was wealthy. It has nothing to do with that. It was, the issue was he was going to spend it on himself. When I think God made him wealthy to share with others. And that was the problem. It was the selfish focus. Turn to Deuteronomy 8 in the Old Testament. And I'm having you go around some of these texts just so you can see what God has to say about this. We're going to read two texts here. Deuteronomy chapter 8. And he was talking to the people of Israel. What the context of, this, of Deuteronomy. Deuteronomy, it means the second giving of the law. And so what had happened was the people had come out of Egypt. And because of disobedience, they'd wandered for 40 years. And now they're up on the top part or the west side of Israel. And they're about to cross over Jordan into the promised land. And it was a whole new generation. And so Moses was giving the law a second time so they could understand this. And he's giving them a warning. He's saying, listen, it's been hard. You've worked hard. And now what's going to happen is you're going to go in and you're going to forget God. Because things are going to go good. So be careful with that. I start at verse 10, Deuteronomy 8. When you have eaten and are satisfied, praise the Lord your God for the good land that he has given you. Be careful that you do not forget the Lord your God, failing to observe his commandments, his laws, or his decrees that I'm giving you this day. Otherwise, when you eat and are satisfied, when you build fine houses and settle down, and when your herds and flocks have grown large and your silver and gold increase, and all you have is multiplied, then your heart will become proud, and you will forget the Lord your God who brought you out of Egypt and out of the land of slavery. We'll stop there. So what he's saying is, listen, when things are bad is when people are close to God, almost always, right? That's when you're in need or when you feel the need, you start praying to God and you ask God to help you. But when things are going good, you kind of think like, yeah, I'm doing pretty good. You're like, I'm working hard and the work is paying off. He's saying be careful here because what's going to happen is you're going to forget. When things start going good, you're going to forget God. Don't do that. Don't forget God who brought you out of the land of slavery. And then go over to verse 16, same chapter. God gave you manna to eat in the desert, something your fathers had not known, to humble you and to what?
Test.
To test you. So in the end, it might go well with you. Verse 17. You may say to yourself, my power and the strength of my hands have produced this wealth for me. That's what a lot of people say. But remember, it is the Lord your God, for it is he who gives you the ability to produce wealth. So it's God's ability that allows you to produce wealth, not your ability. That should be a wake-up call. And if so, then we should partner with God. These are all really, really good verses, by the way. Let's go back to James one more verse. James 5:7. Be patient then, brothers, until the Lord's coming. See how the farmer waits for the land to yield its valuable crop and how patient he is for the autumn and spring rains. The last point that I want to make in the sermon is this, is generous people partner with God to produce wealth. They partner with God. Since God is the source, then what the thing it would be make sense to partner. Just like a farmer partners with God for crops. And they were an agricultural society, and so they knew this. And so what we want to do is, there's several different parts of God, for God and for us. God's part is to produce rain and sun in the genetic growth process. Sometime this summer, when you're eating corn, here's what I'd like you to do. And probably just the parents should do this. But take, if you can get a piece of corn and slice it, do you know what you find when you slice the little kernel? Anybody ever done this? It's a seed, but what do you find inside there? It's like a little corn stalk with a little leaf on it. It's the most awesome thing. It's like a mini plant inside the corn kernel. And it's genetic. In other words, you put that in the ground, that little corn stalk pops out of that little kernel. The rest of it is food to give it food source, fertilizer basically for the rest of it. And it's more details than that, but the simplicity is there's a little corn stalk in there and it pops out. Now part of the God part of this growing is that God is the one who does that. And it's really awesome. So God's part is to produce that genetic growth process along with the sun and rain. What's the farmer's part? His part is to prepare the soil, plant the seed, gather the harvest, and be patient and trust God. And so there's parts that we do too. There's somebody who is from New York City came up, and they were driving by the countryside. And they saw a farmer out in his garden, and it was lush. I mean, the tomatoes were just hanging ripe, and the corn was, you know, tasseled out, and everything was beautiful with cucumbers, the whole deal. And the person rolled down his window and he yelled out to the farmer, he says, "You got a beautiful looking garden." The farmer says, "Thank you." He says, "God really did a great thing in making the garden." The farmer goes, "Well, you should have seen what it looked like when he had it. There was no garden there. It was just all this trashy stuff." He said, "Well, garden, yeah, I put some work into it too, in effect." And I think that's what God wants out of our life. He'll produce the strength, the insight, the resources, but he wants us to partner with him to do something very significant. And you know what I'm talking about, because when it works, it's like you could do this thing all day long and you don't even get tired because it's so fun. And I just want to commend so many of you, you know, like Scott, for instance, you know, he's leaving us and moving on, and God bless the church that gets him with his family. But I appreciate people who dive into ministry and serve each other. You know, in just a few short weeks, the cafe out here is going to be prepared. They're doing a great job, and we need people to help and serve people with joy and make stuff and sit down and have conversations and lead people to Christ and encourage people. What a joyous option that is. And he's given us so much for us to give back to him. It's a great privilege. And I think it's good. It's a good place to be. Right? See? So let's close in prayer, and then we'll go from here. Thank you, Lord, for this day. Thank you that we can study the scriptures, and we can see what you have for us this day. We thank you that you've been so generous to us, and may we be generous to others. Help us to sense that in our hearts when it's time to help with financially or service or whatever it is, that we do it with great joy and God's strength. It's a privilege. In Christ's name we pray. Amen. So, we will finish the service just with an exhortation to, there's other Sunday school classes that are in your bulletin. Some meet next door in the White House. We're meeting upstairs for another class, and there's classes for your children. The senior high is not here because a number of them are over in Camp Rhea this day. But other than that, that's where we go next. So thank you for coming, and God bless you all. Raising good to see you.